Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service here at Emmanuel Canyon. We welcome our visitors and also those joining us on our recorded service. Today is the 12th Sunday after Pentecost, and we hear, or God teaches us another hard truth: the humble will be exalted, and the exalted will be humbled. And we'll see in our sermon text from Proverbs chapter 25 that we are to know our place. May God be praised, and may we be blessed. And we begin with our opening hymn, hymn number 911, God, We Sing Your Glorious Praises, hymn 911.
Thank you.
follow the service setting too. It begins on page 172 in the hymnal. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature, and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our service continues with the responsive canticle on page 174, Lord have mercy. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord of grace and mercy, teach us by your Holy Spirit to follow the example of your Son in true humility, that we may withstand the temptations of the devil and with pure hearts and minds avoid ungodly pride. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our scripture lessons for this 12th Sunday after Pentecost will find printed in the bulletin beginning on page 2. And the theme for the readings, the third hard truth that God is teaching us, is that the humble will be exalted and the exalted will be humbled. We see that in our all three readings, including our first lesson from Proverbs, also today's sermon text, where King Solomon provides common sense about humility and pride. Proverbs chapter 25, verses 6 and 7. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among his great men. It is better for him to say to you, "Come up here," than for him to humiliate you before his nobles. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our service continues with our psalm for today, Psalm 112a, Light Dawns in the Darkness, on page 112. You join in singing Psalm 112a. Judges with evil thoughts. Listen, my dear brothers and sisters, Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder." If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our service continues with the Gospel Acclamation on page 179, and we'll follow the seasonal verse for God's Word. Please stand and join me in singing the Gospel Acclamation. Humility and promises that those who humble themselves will be exalted. From Luke chapter 14, first verse and then verses 7-14. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor. For a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, "Give this person your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, although they cannot repay you. You will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated for the hymn of the day, hymn 729, Son of God, Eternal Savior. 729. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Our sermon text for today, our first reading, just two verses from Proverbs. Proverbs 25, verses 6 and 7. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among his great men. It is better for him to say to you, come up here, than for him to humiliate you before his nobles. This is God's word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, teach us to curb our pride and to nurture our humility, just like Jesus. Amen. Do you know your place? Well, that's the theme for today's sermon. Know your place. Be humble before the King and be raised by the King. And you have to compare the Old Testament lesson with Jesus' parable in our gospel lesson. Very similar. In fact, maybe Jesus is thinking about Solomon's proverb before us today. As I was thinking about our sermon text for today, I thought about the disciples following Jesus' miracle, the feeding of the 5,000. He preached a sermon where he says, I am the bread of life, in John chapter 6. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. And the disciples probably thought, well, that's an easy enough teaching to accept. But then Jesus went on farther in the chapter, and he says, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. And then you wonder, the disciples, is Jesus promoting cannibalism, drinking his blood, eating his flesh? What's he talking about? And toward the end of the chapter, finally, on hearing it, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept it? A hard teaching, a hard truth, that's what's been before us the last couple of weeks. 2 weeks ago, where Jesus said, I have not come to bring peace on earth, but division, war, a separation between believer and unbeliever, even among family members. Or last weekend, it was, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Yeah, enter through the narrow door, not the wide door that leads to destruction, the wide door of your efforts, your good works to earn favor with God and a place in heaven, but no, through the narrow door of repentance and faith in Jesus, who alone is the way, the truth, and the life. And today's hard truth, the humble will be exalted, and the exalted will be humble. Perhaps when you're waiting for the worship service to start, you'd like to read that little paragraph on the front cover of the bulletin, perhaps not, but it really does summarize the three readings, and I encourage you in the future to read that paragraph before church starts. Everyone knows that humility is a positive trait and pride is a negative one. So why bother talking about what we already know? Because in spite of that knowledge, we still helplessly fall into the trap of pride. We cannot help but think that our ascent to the exalted status we desire is our responsibility. We even take our exaltation into our own hands, either by treating poorly those we believe we can stand on top of, or by showing favoritism to those we believe can provide us with upward mobility. Rather than minimizing pride as a sin that is common or harmless, Jesus' words today confront us with this hard truth. Those who exalt themselves will be humbled by God. Jesus also gives us the promise we need to be free from pride's trap. Our exaltation doesn't need to be our responsibility because Jesus has already made it his. Those who humble themselves, Christ will exalt. And so we turn to these verses here in Proverbs chapter 25. Last Sunday, I shared an African proverb with you. Here, 1,000 years before Christ, King Solomon shares a proverb with us. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among his great men, It is better for him to say to you, come up here, than for him to humiliate you before his nobles. Know your place. Be humble before the king at his table. Be raised by the king at his table. Jesus had to deal with two different types of people in our gospel lesson, as did Solomon, both of whom were committing the sin of pride. First, with false humility, people that have low self-esteem, that cover up their weaknesses in order to look good in front of others. And we'll see an example of that. And then secondly, those who are obviously full of themselves, puffed up with pride, who actually believe that they are better than others and not afraid to say it or show it. First, false humility. And Jesus dealt with both types using two tools, a mirror and a needle. A mirror to show them their sin of false humility, and a needle to pop their balloon of pride. I thought about a story that Jesus told and the account why he told it with the Good Samaritan. It's recorded in right here. There you go. In Luke chapter 10. And before the parable that Jesus told, there was occasion for this parable when an expert in the law comes to Jesus and asks the question, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life? He's an example of false humility. Oh, teacher, you are so wise and I am so foolish. What good thing must I do? And Jesus just says, okay, what are the commandments say? Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. Do this and you will live. But then that little part says, he said, but he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? False humility, a sneaky type of pride. And so Jesus told him the parable of the Good Samaritan that you all know. And then Jesus asked the question, which of these three men do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. Jesus used that tool, the mirror of God's law, to show him his sin and his need for a Savior, his sin of false humility, and his Savior who told that parable. And then the other example of pride would be the obvious pride of puffing yourself up and putting others down. Once Jesus was meeting with Pharisees, and they condemned him for healing on the Sabbath. Jesus quotes from Isaiah, you people, you honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. You follow rules taught by men. Or one time with his disciples, he saw the two men that went to the temple to pray. The tax collector who prayed in genuine repentance, and the Pharisee who held his hands high in pride. Oh Lord, I thank you that I am better than all men, including that Pharisee in the corner. But then Jesus used that other tool, not the mirror of God's law, but the needle to pop his balloon. Dear friends in Christ, there's a little bit of false humility, the expert in the law, or a little bit of puffed up pride, the Pharisee in the temple, in all of us. And that's what we're learning in our meditations this week, based on James. Right? Our sins have been forgiven, and yet we still carry around that sinful nature and Satan's temptation that wants to lead us to take credit for our own salvation. To say, oh Lord, you're so important and I'm so unworthy. Let me help you carry me to the way to heaven. Or the Pharisees, as they wear wear their robes and lift their noses high so that small birds can fly through their nostrils while they're blowing their whistle and putting down other people. Jesus used that parable in our gospel lesson, and Solomon summarizes it as we take our seat at the king's table. Know your place. Do not exalt yourself in the king's presence, and do not claim a place among great men. It is better for him to say to you, "Come up here," than for him to humiliate you before his nobles. Be humble before the king. Not false humility, genuine humility. It sees yourself in the mirror, that feels that needle, that prick of your conscience. Repent, believe, and live. And then be raised by the king. It's one of my favorite Easter hymns. O sons and daughters of the king. We weren't born into the royal family. It's by God's grace that he sent his son Jesus to be our brother, to live a perfect life, to suffer and die on the cross, and to rise again, to earn for us these free gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation, and the Holy Spirit that then adopts us as God's own children, as sons and daughters of the king, giving us a place at our master's table that we don't deserve, giving a place at the heavenly banquet for some of our loved ones who've been called home. O sons and daughters of the king. It was a hymn that I've been using in my visits this week at our Tuesday St. John's Council meeting, and also in my visit a week ago Thursday with Janet Getz. Her husband, John, had been suddenly called home last month. And as I sat in her living room, she confessed that she had been diagnosed with cancer, lung cancer that spread to her bones. And so we prayed, "Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood be shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. And we know, Jesus said, no one can come to me unless the Father draws him. That if we believe, then the Holy Spirit gets the credit. Lamb of God, I come. Yesterday morning I was writing an outline for my sermon in the office, and I got a phone call from Janet's sister with the news that she died on Friday night at the hospital. Teach us to number our days. Our life here on earth is a snap of fingers compared to our life with Jesus in heaven. Last morning I picked up a friend to come to church with me who's also grieving the loss of his wife. And I said, "Gene, you're going to love this song by our Martin Luther College Choir entitled I Will Rise." And so we played it. I turned up the volume and we both had tears in our eyes. And he said, "You know, Pastor, next time we go fishing, let's just bring that song along. We don't need to catch fish." It is better for him to say to you, "Come up here," than for him to humiliate you before his nobles. This is our joy. This is our confidence. To know that we have a place at our king's table. But think about those who don't. Think about the opportunities that you have to share the good news with them. You know, my office has been filled up with a bunch of boxes and flyers and door hangers, which is a good thing. Our evangelism committee is busy canvassing and passing out flyers and door hangers with all kinds of church and school information, including an invitation to our Branches Band concert on the Ball Diamond, 6 o'clock on Saturday, September 10th. The new owners of the theater are members of our church and asked, "Pastor, would you like to use our theater to show any Christian movies as an outreach opportunity?" Well, yeah. Stay tuned. Use those opportunities you have to share the good news, because life is short. And there's only one way
to heaven through Jesus. Freely receive, freely give, for Jesus' sake. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our service continues with the Creed, the Nicene Creed this morning, that begins on page 180 in the front of our hymnal. Please stand and join me as we confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Our service continues then with our prayers. First, a prayer for genuine Christian humility, for the sick and others facing trials, for two anniversaries, wedding anniversaries, for Mark and Patty Eamon, who celebrated their 38th wedding anniversary on the 25th, and for Don and Mary Luck, also St. John's members, who will celebrate their 63rd wedding anniversary tomorrow. We offer a prayer for the family of Janet Getz that I mentioned in my sermon, who was called home late Friday evening. And also with school starting, or maybe has already started, for Christian education. Let us pray. Lord, do with us as seems best in your own eyes. Only give us, we ask, a humble and patient spirit to wait expectantly for you. Make our service acceptable to you while we live, and ourselves ready for you when we die, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. In humility, value others above yourselves, Paul writes in Philippians chapter 2. But Jesus, when your disciples argued over who was the greatest among them, you helped them and me to understand that greatness is defined through your loving service to others. Through loving service to others. No one is greater than you, Jesus, who gave your life to save the world from sin. This truth helps me see how important every soul is to you. I see how I can help others by sharing with them how special they are, having been purified from sin by you, Jesus. Together, Lord, you call us all to be your sons and daughters through faith in Jesus Christ and give us a place at the King's table. Thank you, Lord, for making every soul important. Help me think humbly of my neighbor's importance. Lord Jesus, your mercies are new every morning. We thank you for the years of grace which you sustained your servants, Mark and Patty Eamon, Don and Mary Luck, during their married life. We ask that you continue to fill their hearts with the unselfish love that reflects your sacrificial love for them, so that their love for each other may never grow weary. With every joy and sorrow that they share, Bring them closer to each other and to you, their God and Lord. Encourage all husbands and wives as they seek to fulfill their marriage promises, and bless all our homes with your abiding peace. We pray that you would comfort the family of Janet Getz, whom you called to your side late Friday evening. Comfort them with the sure hope that those who die through faith in Jesus only fall asleep here on this life and wake up in his arms in heaven. Dear Lord, it is truly a blessing to be able to study your word on a regular basis. We thank you for the gift of Christian education. As our Lutheran elementary schools, our Sunday schools prepare to open their doors for another year, we are thankful for the opportunity to provide the lambs under our care with the Christian education they need to strengthen their hearts and minds. We also thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to attend adult Bible classes. This is another way to learn more about you and your word. Lord, we also thank you for the pastors and teachers, laymen and laywomen who use their talents in the area of Christian education. We ask you to bless their work. In Jesus' name, amen. And we ask that our offerings please be brought forward. And if you haven't yet, please leave a record of your attendance using the card or the QR code with your smartphone, or just the paper cards, filling that in. And you can leave those in the basket at the end of the service. Heavenly Father, accept our offerings. Praise God for whom all blessings flow, blessings that we can't count and we don't deserve. Eternal life with you. He conquered our enemies and gain for us the kingdom of grace and joy. Bless us as we receive your Son's body and blood, and lead us to remember his suffering, death, and resurrection. Forgive our sins, and fill us with the hope of new life in heaven. Hear our praise and receive our thanks as we worship you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen.